Hi, I'm Ramit Sahani. I'm a technical lead at Tower Research Capital and a research group lead at Midas at IIIT Delhi. I'm a machine learning researcher, and I've been doing research in the fields of natural language processing and artificial intelligence in the last 3 years. Over the span of these 3 years, I've come to learn more about what is research and specifically what is a research paper. In this video, I'd like to go over specifically what is a research paper, what does it constitute of, and most importantly, how does one go about writing a research paper? That being said, I'll start describing briefly what exactly goes into a research paper and what does one look like. Talking about research papers, one of the things that's helped me often is known as Google Scholar. This is a repository where you can go and see multiple different papers. You can read papers, see who has published these papers, how many times they've been cited, what years they came up on, and everything. This is a good way of getting into research papers. And my personal suggestion, as well as my own experience, has been based on reading multiple such research papers. Over here, you see my specific profile, which lists some of the papers that I've had published year over year with several of the authors that I've published such work with. Without getting into too much detail here, I think it becomes important to look at what does such a research paper look like. So here's one of my research papers that was presented at a natural language processing conference earlier in 2020. The key idea of a research paper is to succinctly present some novel ideas or some new improvements in methods that already exist for solving some new kind of problem. The idea of a research paper is different from that of a project report, where one would maybe repeat experiments that have already been done, but rather with a research paper, one needs to publish new findings that would further the community. Specifically, a research paper then consists of a certain title, which is a brief summary of what the research paper is about. The authors and their affiliations of who have contributed to this research paper. Being an author on such research papers is a good way of showing that you're capable of doing independent research or in groups, as well as contributing to novel open problems in the world. Research papers then often include an abstract. The abstract is a good short summary of what the research paper constitutes. In this paper specifically, we look at using historical data to predict a person's suicide on social media. The idea here is social media often has many people exhibiting suicide ideation, thoughts of suicide. And what we're trying to do with this research paper is take one step ahead in showing how neural networks can be used to improve prediction of suicide ideation on Twitter. Often research papers after an abstract consist of an introduction. The introduction and the key idea here is mostly to emphasize and motivate why we want to solve this problem. A pattern I like to follow in such research papers is first explain why is the certain problem that we're tackling important. In the case of suicide, we've discussed some certain statistics on why we need to study it in general, as well as why we need to study it on social media. Often introductions can have figures, which are a good, easy way of introducing the reader to understand most of what the research paper is about or the crux of the problem that we're trying to solve. In a sense, an interesting thing that I've learned and seen over the years is that maybe 100,000 people read your research paper title, maybe 10% of that read the abstract. Even a smaller 10% of that fraction is the one that reads your introduction. And the tiniest portion actually goes through the entire paper. So it becomes increasingly important to have a strong abstract and introduction that can motivate the reader to continue reading through. As you proceed ahead, another interesting section that research papers often consists of is known as related work. The idea of related work here is to contextualize where does your work stand with respect to other work. For example, what has been done in suicide ideation already? Why is the work done in this paper important? And why can't it be done by existing methods? So the key idea of related work is to contextualize where your work stands and motivate to people who read the paper that this method is something that brings a new contribution to the world. Often after the related work comes one of the most important sections, which is known as the methodology. The idea of the methodology is to summarize your algorithms, your neural network models, the problems you're solving, and mathematically define what you're trying to do. In our specific case, you'll often see that methodology includes heavier mathematical notations, includes diagrams that helps explaining what is being done in this paper. So the methodology is often a section that takes a long time to write, where we need to go through several iterations, making sure that not only does the mathematical aspect tie out, but also formally follows all conventions and is easy to understand. With research papers, although we often have great ideas, it's very important to also make sure that these ideas work in the real world settings. Often for this, we need to do experiments. And with how fast machine learning and AI has advanced, it becomes easy to do these experiments on repositories like Google Colab, Kaggle, etc. Experiments often involve real world data sets. In our case, we look at a data set back from 2019 on suicide ideation detection and solve a classification task on predicting if users are suicidal or non-suicidal based on their tweets. Experimentation or experiment sections often involve descriptions of such data sets. For example, how many data samples were there? What was the data set imbalance? Where did this data set come from? What kind of pre-processing was done on such a data set, etc. Speaking to my earlier point, an interesting part of research papers is to demonstrate that your method works, but also how well does it work in comparison to other research that has been published. For example, in this part of baseline methods, I compare our new proposed approach with a paper of mine back from 2018. The idea here is to establish quantitatively and qualitatively on why the certain approach in the paper works better and how much better is it. Do we actually need this to be in a paper, or is this something that the community can live without? The key idea I like to always think about before I publish a research paper or submit a research paper is to make sure that whatever we're presenting contributes positively to the world and brings new insights to the topic that's being studied. Once the settings, method, related work, and reasons on why this work is being done has been contextualized, the most important part comes on summarizing how well does the model do. For example, in our case, comparative performance can be summarized through tables, bar plots, which all summarize based on different metrics, how our model compares to other existing models. An example here is one of these baselines from 2018 performs or gets an accuracy of only 55%, but our latest model gets an accuracy of around 85%. Presenting these results in such a manner is an important step in terms of convincing readers, as well as people, that the problem we're trying to solve with this complex a method will add certain value. Results can often be in several different dimensions, where we can do comparisons across the model within different components of the model, do analysis over time, and also qualitatively look at some samples. For example, here we study certain users, see what kind of tweets they've made, and then analyze what kind of embeddings have been generated and see how different models perform. In short, the results section is a good way of convincing reviewers as well as people who would read this research paper that this research makes a certain contribution and this is how well the proposed model works. Talking further in terms of the kind of aspects and parts of a research paper, usually we often have a discussion or a conclusion section, which talks more about the practical implications, ethical considerations, if any, and concludes on how such a paper would contribute to the real world. At the end of a research paper, after conclusion, we often have acknowledgements, and at the end, we have references. The key idea of any research is to build on existing research, and often with references, we tie out to earlier published research papers and see how they compare to our method or see what we can add to our paper based on the findings made by these research papers. In short, a research paper is a document of varying length. I've seen research papers go all the way from 2 pages, such as student papers or extended abstracts, all the way to over hundreds of pages, such as the research paper about the Common Python Library NumPy. In short, research papers are a good way of summarizing why we need to solve a certain problem, give a background on why this problem is being solved, say how we have specifically solved this problem, and at the end of the day, convince through experiments and results that our method produces ABC list of contributions. And that's why this paper would be a good resource for the community to come ahead. The process of publishing such research papers is a different aspect. Specifically, research papers can be published in conferences as well as journals. Often we submit a research paper anonymously. This is known as a double-blind submission, where we make a submission. We have reviewers who don't know what our identity is, and we don't know the identity of the reviewers. These reviewers often are experts in the fields and match to these papers based on their own prior experience. At this point, reviewers then anonymously review the paper, identify strengths and weaknesses, and give feedback on how the paper can be improved. At this point, there are multiple different outcomes that can come out. The paper could directly be accepted, it could be rejected, there could be revisions suggested. Ultimately, if a paper is accepted, the paper is often published, as you see the paper on my screen right now, in a certain conference proceedings or in journals, and is also presented. The key idea of getting such a research paper is then to build a repository of the kind of work that you publish, as well as communicate with different people on your key ideas, contribute to a field, and most importantly, network and talk to people who work in similar research areas collectively to make the world a better place. In short, research papers have been a good way of allowing beginners to step into the world of research, first by reading, then by experimenting, and finally by writing their own research papers. Personally, I feel research papers have been something that have helped me drastically build on research in my career experience. And I hope that through this video, there's a greater interest in how one publishes research papers, the brief understanding and logistics involved, as well as what are research papers. That being said, I am Ramit Sahani. I can be contacted through LinkedIn, or can be contacted in general. In case you want to talk about research, research papers, feel free to hit me up and I'm happy to chat. Thank you for your time. Bye-bye.
Thank you so much for joining us on a Sunday evening. Just wanted to borrow some time of today's evening from Ramit. Ramit is a celebrated data scientist researcher who has, you know, whom we have been talking to help us figure out the intricacies of data science. And we thought, let's use this holiday, let's use this a bit of free time that all of us have to catch up on what makes data science so elusive, what makes it so exciting, why so many youngsters are just talking about data science, artificial intelligence, machine learning, why those buzzwords are so frequently seen in resumes, and how can people actually start exploring that domain, right? So just for everyone who's joined in, thank you so much once again. We have Ramit with us. Ramit, would you like to maybe introduce yourself, who you are, where do you come from?
Yeah, sure. Cool. So thank you everyone for joining. Happy Independence Day. And yeah, really grateful that people had an hour to take out on a holiday. I'm sorry for doing this on a Sunday. And yeah, really grateful for all your time. And thanks to Scalar and Saurabh for hosting me. Hopefully we can take some of your questions and answer some of the things that people have in mind. A little bit about me very quickly. So I'm Ramit. I finished undergrad just 3 years ago. Although 3 years ago feels like a long time, I've aged very quickly. But just 3 years ago, finished bachelor's from NSIIT Delhi in computer engineering. Since the last 3 years, I've been working as a technical lead at Tower Research Capital. It's a high frequency trading firm. And over these 3 years, I've also expanded some of the machine learning research I do. I think, like a lot of people here in this session, the whole era of machine learning, although started a long time ago, it started picking up more commonly in India, etc., over the last few years. And during that time, I was also getting interested in research, undergraduate thesis, things like that. And that's what led to me getting involved in machine learning, artificial intelligence. Over these 3 years, I guess I've been honored to have collaborations with several different universities, professors, and everything. And it's all led to a good number of research publications and output. And the whole idea behind this is, as a community, to, for India especially, to contribute to research. I think research has made a lot of progress abroad. But in India, although there is a huge demand in terms of understanding how we get into research, there's little to do in terms of how people are actually achieving it. And the goal of this session is hopefully to bridge that gap a little bit.
Right. Amazing. I mean, I would love to know all the juicy details about research and everything, but before we jump into that, maybe give us a quick walkthrough of what your introduction to machine learning was. What got you excited about this field?
Sure. So it's a rather funny story, and it's not the most inspiring story. Back when I was in my last year of undergrad at NSIIT, me and my friends decided that we need to get a lot of marks. Okay. So we decided we were hungry for marks. And interestingly, I'm department rank 1 in NSIIT, and the thesis had something to contribute towards to it. So I figured that doing any kind of research papers might be a good way. Like, if we can publish our thesis, it might lead to more marks. So very selfish, useless agenda, nothing more than that. So we wrote a paper, and the thesis advisor suggested that let's publish it in a local conference in India, which is what most people do. Our group decided that why don't we try something a little more ambitious. Let's try one of these big international conferences. And the teacher initially discouraged us. We decided that, you know, there's no harm in trying, let's just go with it. 2 months later, the paper got accepted with some great feedback, saying that although it doesn't look like a research paper, because, well, we had no experience about research papers, but they said the core ideas make sense. So we're happy to publish the paper. And this happened in ACL, top NLP conference. Once that happened, I figured that maybe this was just luck. I wasn't sure. In fact, the conference coincided with my first day at Tower Research. So, like an insane person, I decided that full-time employment matters more. I decided to skip the conference. But then part of me realized that, you know, that's something incomplete. I would like to go on a free trip. So research papers involve free trips. You get to go to all these conferences and all of that. Eat a lot of good food. So I figured, why not? So as within Tower Research, I was still connected with some of my college friends. And I think this is something for everyone. Although you can't reach out to professors and all immediately, your friends are still people who can help you out. So as friends, we continued publishing some papers in small workshops, not student tracks. When you start, you don't want to start very big. You can't directly compete with Google Brain and Stanford. So we decided, let's start easy, small. We published some work on very tiny applications like tweet classification for suicide intent. And as you attend these conferences, so I think the key idea is you need to start somewhere. Like a lot of people I see take a lot of time thinking about roadmaps, making plans, doing courses. All that's great, but you need to start somewhere. If you don't start, then you're wasting some time there. So after I began, we got a few papers published. Once we published a few papers, I finally got to attend ACL the next year. This was in Florence. And that's when you meet like tens of thousands of researchers, Google Brain, Stanford, DeepMind, everyone is there. And they're all willing to talk to you, guide you. That happened, and this so it was just luck in a way. You know, the paper got accepted. We just friends did some stuff just for an undergraduate thesis. No advice, no guidance. We didn't even know what a research paper looks like. I spent, I think, nights looking at what other people have published to see, okay, let me copy this from them. Let me copy this, the presentation. Let me try to make a figure like they do. And today, if you go and see the papers I wrote 3 years ago, in 2018, to the papers now, they've grown in how they look. But the key idea is basically, it's just what you pick up as you keep doing. So I think advice for everyone here is don't worry before taking that first step. Just start. Right. Even if it's with your friends, don't have friends, just do it solo.
Right. I mean, I can already see that a lot of people in chat already resonate with the statement that you're making. For example, we have Ritwik, who is saying that, hey, I get scared with the idea of doing research. How do I even start? Right? We will start taking a lot of these questions one by one. Maybe let's just start at the beginning, right? So you mentioned one very important piece that India, while there's a lot of demand and there's a lot of conversations, it does not have a very strong research platform as of today, right?
Yeah.
So when somebody is thinking about research and they actually want to make it something important, then they have to think about approaching universities outside India, right?
Yeah.
Or approaching research institutes outside India. How do they go about that?
Right. So I feel over time, the research culture has been improving. Universities like IIIT Delhi, Manipal, I think from all tiers, it's not a tier thing. I think a lot of people come to me and tell me that we're in tier three, we can't even think of research papers. But I think times have changed to the place where people alone, you don't need a professor to publish a paper. I know so many people, including myself, where we did not know any professor who had any publishing background. But we decided that we can try doing it on our own. So the worst case scenario, you don't get anyone at all. There are definitely options to do it on your own. But regardless, I think the best idea is to always try reaching out to people. At times, people worry that I have nothing on my resume, so I shouldn't reach out. Well, the one thing I've learned over these 3 years is, the answer is always going to be no if you never ask. So even if you don't ask professors, you should reach out to people who do or publish research papers. For example, in fact, more than 50% of the team that I have today in IIIT Delhi, Georgia Tech, they're all random people who message me on LinkedIn. I had no idea what they were. I've never met them in my life. And I have co-authored papers with them simply because they took the first step in saying, this is our resume, can you take a look at it? And in fact, that's how I started. So it goes back to 2017, 2018, when I decided I want to try looking at what research looks like. So I wrote a message on LinkedIn, like a generic template kind of message. Edited it out, made it a little specific for every company, and sent that to over 100 people. Of those 100 people, I think 6 or 7 replied, and most of them replied, we don't have the time. 95 didn't even reply. But one person from IBM Research said that, why don't we have a chat? So out of 100, just one person gave me a chance to have a chat. And within 2 weeks, I was interning at their Delhi office. So the idea in terms of starting out is do things on your own, take those first steps, and if you don't know what those first steps are, try reaching out to people on LinkedIn. I think with how open things are now, you can just message anyone. In fact, feel free to message me, ask me questions, and I'm happy to answer those. In fact, as this exercise of what I'm starting with scale up, you'll see more content around how to get into AI, like more detailed steps. But I think the first step is always this, that you need to start. I think I see a few questions here from Mudit, Tolik, Ritwik, where even Anhat, where people wonder that you know, for research, you always need an absolutely fresh new idea. It's not right. It's okay if you repeat what other people have done. For example, very simple thing. I think everyone has studied some problem in data science, like how do I, everyone's done things like classifying an email as spam or not spam. Everyone's done that problem. But how do you publish a paper like that? So you don't need to improve performance. You don't need to do X, Y, Z. You just need to do some extra analysis. Why don't you do email classification for spam or not spam in Malayali, for example? That's not been done before. So it doesn't have to be the fanciest, trickiest mathematical idea. It can always be simple things like, why don't we use the power of India? So, you know, a lot of research labs that work within India, ShareChat is a good example of one of the new booming startups in India, where the whole idea is around regional languages. So we've made progress. Like, Google search works great in English. Have you tried Google search in Bengali? Have you tried it in Arabic? Maybe not, but how well does it work? So problems are many, and you need to start working with these problems to realize. You start wondering, where do I start? It's difficult to start. But if you start with any random thing, you will find something to take it ahead.
So if we just oversimplify and summarize it, the first step is to get started. You can just think about the smallest or the most closest idea to you, right? It could be geography specific. It could be a cross-domain implementation or something that is already being done, right? Awesome. And for example, you have this idea, you've started reaching out to companies, you've started reaching out to people, right? Now, when you hear back, how should you frame your conversations? Because like you said, you know, out of 100, only maybe two might reply, right? Arshit, we would have loved to converse in Hindi, but for example, a lot of our audience members might not be Hindi comfortable, right? So English makes it more easy. No other reason.
Arshit, you should message me separately. I'll talk to you in Hindi. I can speak well enough Hindi, so I'll talk to you in Hindi soon.
Yeah. Awesome. So you have this great idea. You reached out to a lot of people. Like you said, out of 100, one might reply, right? Now you reached out to a lot of people. Somebody has replied. How do you make the most out of those conversations? How do you prepare for those conversations?
Yeah. So I think that's a great question. And I think the main idea in anything, this is not just about research, but even a full-time industry role, anything, applying for masters, doing JE and applying for undergraduate college, you need to show that you bring value. Right? You can't just claim that I bring value. I can't just say that I've made Google search so well, you hire me. You need to do something and show it. So in something like JEE, you need to get a certain rank to get there. Similarly, with research, you need to have something of your own. It doesn't need to be a research paper to start. If you have a research paper, that's great. That shows that you can independently take a problem and do everything. But why not do a project? So, you know, everyone has projects on their resume, right? Try to find a project that's the closest to the company that you're applying to. For example, if you're doing Amazon, you want to apply to Amazon as an intern, why don't you message some people who work in Amazon saying that I'm working on a recommendation system for mobiles or fashion or anything like that? So in that case, the idea simply is have something to demonstrate. If you walk into a conversation without anything to back up your claims, it's not going to work. In fact, when I started out, I would make claims like, you know, I want to do this and I can improve this neural network. But then people would say that, have you done it already? You won't know if you've not taken that challenge head on. So be company specific, don't be generic. Like, you can't say the same thing you said to Amazon to also say, for example, Uber, right? It's difficult in some cases. If you've done something around work related to maps, tell Uber that I've worked on some maps recommendation, traffic forecasting, anything like that. And it makes the conversation easy for them. You know, you're requesting to take someone else's time. So in that case, you need to make sure that it adds some kind of value to them rather than just saying, you can't just say something. And surprisingly, it's very surprising to me that people on LinkedIn, in fact, to me as well, I get messages for referrals, positions at research papers, things like that. And they just say that we want to do this. But there are 100 people who want to do this, including me. So what makes you different? And what makes you different is, you know, some project, something tangible that you have to show.
Amazing. I mean, I think that was a very, very detailed insight. You have to bring something concrete with your idea that shows that you are actually invested in it. right? You're not waiting for us to give you an opportunity. You're not waiting for the institute to give you an opportunity. You've already started, and now with our help, you want to take it to the next level. So for reference, you can also watch Shark Tank, right? Like you go there, you've already built some business. You are high probability of getting some funding. Amazing.
Yeah.
Another very, very cliche question when it comes to data science machine learning. A lot of people claim to be doing data science machine learning when they are primarily maybe implementing an existing library, or when they might be primarily using something that's already there as a plugin, right? How do we build that self-discipline when we are able to assess, okay, where do I stand capability-wise? Am I actually doing something concrete?
Right. So I feel a lot of what people think, and it's a myth that will get busted over time. A lot of times people think that you need to change something mathematically to publish a paper or to get into research, but there's often production related stuff. In fact, that's, you know, it goes with a question on the chat as well around academic research and industry research. Often things like industry research could be more focused on productionizing ML models. So in fact, in industry, very often we don't write our own algorithms. We don't change things. Often you would just implement stuff, import libraries, but there's a whole game around how to optimize these, what parameters are good, and writing production kind of pipeline. So I think it depends on what your interest is. Are you someone who wants to do more ML engineering, more ML ops, maybe more business for data science? Or do you want to be someone who's doing more groundbreaking research work? And the con with doing groundbreaking research work is you're going to hit into roadblocks more often. You'll try 10 ideas. And very recently, I was having this conversation with someone in Facebook research where they told me that in research, if you have 10 ideas, and if more than two of those work, you're doing something wrong in terms of research. So the whole idea is, you know, you're going to hit roadblocks, and there might be years before you come up with good ideas, or there might be certain cases where you do everything in 10 days. So an example, in fact, of that is, so the tagline of this discussion, these award-winning papers. So the first award-winning paper I got, we finished that paper start to end with the idea, like idea conception to writing the paper, code, everything was done in 11 days, just because the first idea we got worked out. And then there have been papers which are, you know, I've been working on since 2018 and they still haven't been published. So it's always a, you know, thing on luck as well. Or even, you know, research is something which is like going into a dark alley, but doing ML engineering or things, like, are more defined steps.
Right. I think because you just touched up upon, you know, a lot of these industry related things that are happening can be built into research, right? We have this question from Rupert, if you can elaborate the difference between academic research and industry research.
Right. So I'd say it depends also organization to organization. So I won't name specific organizations, but there are certain places where industry research focuses more on taking existing things and applying them. For example, there are a lot of startups where they would take something that Google has launched or DeepMind has launched, and then they try to build a product around it. Maybe something like text-to-speech, maybe something like self-driving vehicle. So a lot of companies would do groundbreaking research on that, and then there's a whole world in taking that to customers. For example, Grammarly is a good idea of it. Grammarly does both. They come up with new ideas and they launch it into their product slowly. But then they have a whole ecosystem built around a product that exists, marketing that to people, etc. So I'd say industry research is more around finding customers and creating value. It can't be a theoretical idea that is groundbreaking. For going even simpler words, I think when something like discovering, like, you know, Bohr's atomic model of all things, discovering that has a huge theoretical significance, does a lot of work for academia and is the building base for hundreds of things. But does it have an immediate thing that you can sell to someone or customers and make money out of immediately? Probably not. So academic research is more about building those foundational blocks, and industry research is more about taking it to customers and, you know, monetizing it. And often a bigger organization like Google, Uber, Amazon, they would have both. So an academic team that focuses on that long-term vision, that we want to improve Google search. So what kind of NLP problem should we solve? And then there's a more industry-oriented thing which says that, okay, let's take this small idea, release it to 5% of users using Google search, and let's see how it does. That's kind of where the division starts.
Awesome. Okay. I think we just have another question by Afla, which is, because you're already working and you might be doing other things, you are mentoring people, you are helping others who reach out on LinkedIn. How do you, I mean, I have just added that part, like, do you actively study new mathematical ideas too? I think he's referring to one of your papers, which is on time-aware LSTMs, leverage things like Riemannian manifolds. Was that something you knew already? If no, how did you proceed? And I would just want to maybe add a bit on how do you manage everything together?
Right. So to start with, on actively looking at new mathematical ideas, I think you have to keep up with academic research, like keeping up with industry. You know, like if new Python library comes up, maybe we all are not up to date with what new is coming up, but at some point pandas didn't exist. And soon enough, we've caught on to that trend. Over the next years, we'll catch up to more libraries that keep coming up. It's difficult to keep up with all new research and like everything. You can't keep up with all new shows, but you end up watching some of them, right? So focus on a subdomain in AI. I think one of the mistakes people make when they start is they don't fix a domain. I've seen people who will do something in computer vision where they're, you know, trying to identify hand-recognized digits. Then they're trying to build their own Alexa. Like, people want to do everything, but when you start, you can't. You have to pick a certain point. So in my case, there are certain domains that I follow, like finance is one of them. And I read papers. I, in fact, have a few bots on Twitter that keep posting some of the new recent papers that come in. Whatever looks like a catchy title, I'll go through it. If it looks interesting, then I'll read all of it. And that's where your source of new ideas comes in. Second source of new ideas is people. So like anything normally, everyone on this would have watched a movie on their friend's recommendation, although you have no idea about the movie yourself. So it's kind of like that.
Understood. And,
Sorry.
No, so I was just saying, so a community also becomes a very important part. Make sure that you're plugged into a community that is very focused on data science, that ensures that you have the creative juices flowing, right? Okay. Now, from a journey perspective, right, you have your idea, you have started reaching out to people, you have already done some concrete work before even starting those conversations. How to pick those institutes that might be most excited about it? Because it's always better if they can find a fitment. Like, right, for example, you mentioned if you're talking to Uber, if you can talk about map related things that you've done, it's more exciting for them, right? Is there a way that people can test their ideas and see, okay, this company or this research institute might be more relevant for me?
Yeah, I think a lot of it has to do with more around what your interests are. So it's kind of like saying, you know, take a more, something that's more relatable to people. It's kind of like saying, what kind of movie would you want to produce? Or what kind of developer do you want to be? Back end, front end, etc. So it depends. Like, are you more interested by natural language? Are you more interested in healthcare? Are you more interested in computer vision? At the end of the day, I feel if you're doing something that you're not interested in, even to get into a certain company, it might get tricky. So it's often best to see what you are interested in. And there will be some kind of, like, you would have got idea for that from somewhere, right? Like, if you got into finance, there'll be financial companies, Tower Research being one of them, where they might be interested in finance plus AI. So you kind of need to see what interests you. And like, I think Nikhilesh mentions, how do you pick domains? So, and here the idea is there's so many exciting things. What do we do? So it's again a matter of, you know, you look at everything for a little bit. You can't watch every show on Netflix. Well, some of you can even. But at times, you know, you need to pick, what do I look at first? An important thing to do is you need to pick something that also looks like it has an easy place to start. I've seen people start with things like reinforcement learning without having any background, without knowing what a neural network is. Then it gets tricky. Okay. You need to know what linear regression is before you get into neural networks. So start by looking at the very basic things. Don't think that, in fact, even with things like LeapFrog, don't jump into the hard problems. It might sound exciting if you can finish a hard problem, but at times the basics are where you need to start. And when you're comfortable with them, you'll automatically find a path which becomes more interesting.
Awesome. Great. So we have the idea, we have created some research, we've started reaching out to people. Everything is all sorted, right? What's next? Now, what separates an award-winning paper to just another paper, right? Where do you draw that line? Okay, these are the characteristics that you want.
Right. So I think the biggest thing is having a paper that produces value. I think, like, very correctly Nikhilesh pointed out, people think that research papers have to be maths heavy, you have to come up with some new function, you have to solve some integral that's never been solved before. None of that. In fact, the first award-winning paper I had no novel maths in it. there was in fact not a very heavy mathematical background. It was just more around an application that creates value in the world. A paper's award-winning status, like an award-winning thing everywhere, is the impact that it can make. For example, maybe we've not used anything novel to detect suicide ideation, but have we come up with something that prevents even 5 suicides that are happening on Twitter? If it does, then it has created impact, and that's what makes it award-winning worthy. So it becomes important for people to realize that don't chase all the fancy things in papers. In fact, some of my papers might have really complicated maths, but you'll find some of them that don't have any maths at all. So it's not about maths or complexity. It's more about the impact that you'll try to create. If it's a problem that has already been solved, like at present, I think I've seen more than 1,000 papers on COVID-19 since it came out. Most of them do the same thing. They do something like, is this tweet about COVID-19 or not? At that point, are you creating more value? Are you creating more impact? Probably not. So the idea is, let's try to create impact and value that will improve AI, improve some application in the world, rather than just chasing, you know, fancier concepts or more complicated looking maths.
Got it. I want to take the next question from Narendra S. Can you list out some institutions or groups who are very active in ML research?
Sure. So I'll answer this for India specifically first, because I feel it's more uncommon to find these in India. I'd say all triple IITs that I've seen are very, very, very not just active. In fact, I was from NSIIT, but there was no research culture there. So I reached out to triple IIT Delhi, and say 95 to 99% of all my papers are at triple IIT Delhi. Besides them being active, it's also very inclusive of an atmosphere. So you will reach out to someone who works at triple IIT Delhi, even some of the people I work with, you will 100% get a response. They will tell you, what can you do? In fact, a lot of these triple IITs, IITs have slightly higher bar at times, but triple IITs, for example, certain industrial labs, they have these intern recruitment cycles. In fact, I've been part of these like for 2 years now, where we'll release a Google form, you put in your interest, and you get a task. The task can be something as simple as building a sentiment classifier or something, and then they take interviews. So it's almost at the point like getting a software engineering internship. So all you need to do is keep in mind that these institutes are hiring, look at their websites, look at their research pages. There are hundreds of research labs in India, hundreds. So if you're an undergraduate student, try looking at what is the research initiative in your college. If not, try finding it in other institutes, or if you have the time, why not create one in your own institute?
How does somebody go about creating a club or a lab of their own in their institute?
So I feel if I had started research 1 year before in NSIIT, not propelled by my greed for marks, then I felt I could have created such a group, because you need, again, it's the same thing. Why will people join your group? Why will people join your company? They see there's a benefit, right? So if you publish a paper within your college, you're going to have college people come to you. Like when I cracked our research, people in college came to me, how do you crack our research? Before that, no one came and asked anything. So if you create some kind of value, some project, or if you do something like Google Summer of Code, in fact, Google Summer of Code also has ML research kind of projects now. So in fact, I think TensorFlow is one of them who has very ML heavy stuff for Google Summer of Code. So once you get some kind of achievement, it becomes easier to attract people. If not, your group of friends can always come up with it. Like it's like creating a finance society. Find people with like-minded interests, generate some value. If you don't generate value and you're just talking about it, maybe over time.
Awesome. Sorry for that sidetrack.
No.
Okay, we have another question from Namrata, which is again on similar lines. How can we shortlist right publishers to submit papers, and how to customize the papers for them?
Okay, so great question, first of all. And I'd say it requires a lot of research. It took me more than a year to figure out where to go. And it depends on what your requirements are, to be honest. Like, I won't be like other people and tell you that you should only target the top conferences. They can be really tricky. I know people who've submitted papers to top, including myself, submitted papers to top conferences more than 10 times and it gets rejected for years because they have a crazy bar. And then there's some where, you get, it's a lower bar. It might not be the most popular conference, but it's still fine. So you need to decide if are you willing to only settle for the topmost, or are you willing to start easy? So my recommendation for people who are starting would be to start with a student track or workshop paper. I started with something known as a student track in a top conference. And that was restricted to undergraduate students. So you can imagine that I'm not competing at least with people in Google Brain and Stanford, right? But over time, the idea is if you want to create value, you should definitely be targeting only the top conferences. If I can post a link, I don't know if I can post. Can I post a link here?
Yes, you can send a link in private chat and then the team will post it in comments.
Let me just do that. So I'm going to post a link of how I look. This is a very standard conference ranking kind of rubric. It's what everyone uses. So it has something like a conference tiering between conference ranks like unranked, C, B, A star. A star papers are really, really difficult to get, but they hold the most value. So when you apply to big companies, they don't just look at how many papers you have. They look at how many A-star papers you have. So idea is, like everything in life, the idea is not to chase quantity, but quality. So make sure that you try to, if you won't go for the best conference, you try for one that has some value.
Understood. Great. I'm just going through the questions that have been posted here. While we have already spoken about it to a certain extent, I still want to take up the question by Soumit Dudeja, which is, any prerequisites for getting into research? What should a freshman focus on in terms of academics and learning, studying, and aiming towards research?
Right, okay. In terms of prerequisites, and okay, this is also around Tower Research, so that later. Around prerequisites, I would say the first part would be having some basic maths background. That doesn't mean you need to know, I don't know, complex calculus, but you should know what derivatives are, you should know probability. So I'd say class 11, 12 maths, you should know at least that much. And you should have some kind of computer science background. Very basic, but you need to know things like loops, if else conditions. If you just start with that much and you can import some basic libraries in Python is a very good and easy way to start. You can do ML in other languages, but it might just be tricky. So some basic Python, some basic maths, and you can start looking at courses, and that's a good way to start. Talking about academics, again, if you can take more ML-focused courses, if you can take maths-heavy courses, that's great. And I would say in terms of courses online, I think there are many. There are courses like the famous Andrew Ng course, which is more theoretical. But then there are also courses which are more about, I think one of them is on Coursera only, around building neural networks with PyTorch. Those are more hands-on. So focus on maths, computer science, and the rest will follow.
Awesome. We spoke about our local universities and which one are providing a much higher support. When you talk about foreign universities, you mentioned emailing them, right? But for example, is there any other alternative as well which makes it easier to reach out to foreign universities? The question by Ajay Mehta.
Right. No, great question. And it's something that used to be very, very, very difficult because emails, well, not everyone replies to emails. In fact, I have a huge pile of mail sitting in my inbox. I'm doing nothing about it. But what's changed is conferences now. So with COVID, not that it's the best thing for us, but one thing that's helped with COVID is things are virtual. So conferences happen virtually. Now that conferences happen virtually, you can reach out to professors in conferences. They're sitting there the whole day, honestly. They have a thing like Zoom sessions, or they have something called GatherTown. For those who don't know, you can Google what GatherTown is. If you've ever played any Pokemon game on Game Boy, your character roams around a world where it meets different Pokemon and people. So GatherTown is something like that. It's an animated world, and as soon as your character comes close to another character, your webcam's on, and you start a conversation like we're having right now. I've met more than 20 to 30 professors like this in virtual conferences where, you know, they're having their morning tea, I'm sitting here late at night, and we talk about common research interests. And this is how I met someone last year who's a professor in Germany. And we had this 5-minute conversation around suicide work. And next thing we know, 5 months later, me and her have published a paper, and you know, we have more coming on the way. At this point, conferences are easy for people to attend because you can do it from your house. You don't have to travel. There's not a lot of money involved. Otherwise, you have to find funding, and you only get funding if you have papers, etc. But in fact, on my LinkedIn, I often post about conferences that I'm attending or presenting papers. Very lately, these conferences have free registration, most of them. Some of them might have something like $10, $20. But at times, they're free. If they're free, you can talk to PhDs, and companies have their booths. last week I was at this conference called ACL virtually. I had a few of my co-authors who've just graduated. They managed to get interviews from Google Research just within 5 minutes because they were in that conference. So in short, if not emails, not Twitter, not LinkedIn, try looking out for conferences at least while they are virtual.
Amazing. Awesome. So I think one of the key statements is also to just put your work out there, you know, whether it's via conferences, whether it's via online communities, whether it's via social circles, just if nothing else, start your own YouTube channel and start talking about whatever you're doing. Right. I mean, I think in today's world, it's just so many channels exist where you can just go out and start sharing what you know. And the more you put out there, the easier you are making it for to be found, for people to find you and reach out to you.
Definitely.
Awesome. I think given the junction that you are at, right, you're as a very senior engineer at Tower Research, and you're doing so much work on the research side as well, right? There's a very important question that Prajwal Mishra has asked. How do you go about an approval from your company to work alongside these institutes? Because I'm sure that all of these companies are also very secret about their work, because it's a lot of IPs, a lot of industry first. How do you go about that?
Right. So I think it depends company to company, not even company to company, but manager to manager. I've been very fortunate to, I say it's luck, quite, I don't know what it is. I've been very fortunate to have managers who, you know, given me their blessing since day one. It's not just do your research. They want to hear about my research. In Tower Research, I've presented my research papers. They want to hear about it. And they're also open to me using some of the ideas I've got in research within the company. But the trick here is you need to keep them separate. You don't mix the two. For example, Tower Research, being a financial trading firm, I can't pick up what I've learned in Tower Research and put it in a research paper. That doesn't work. And that won't work with any company, really. So there are certain domains where I know I can't publish based on discussions I've had with my employer. There are certain cases where I might need to show them a research paper before I publish it. But in most cases, if you can isolate the two, for example, I do research on suicide ideation detection. It has nothing to do with Tower Research. So it becomes easy to do those domains. The only crux here is if you want to manage both, you have to keep them mutually exclusive. And that just means you need to put in more time. So it becomes a matter of don't mix the two. If you can, don't mix the two. Otherwise, try finding a job where research itself is your own job.
Understood. No, that makes a lot of sense. I think the more exclusive they are, the least amount of conflict of interest, and the easier it is. We have a question from Srinivas. I think you've already touched about it, that you know, you have some bots that help you with a lot of content, and then you pick and choose which one do you want to consume. But I think a lot of content consumption also goes into research, making sure that you're updated, making sure about what's happening. How do you keep track of everything that's happening in the industry, and how do you make sure that you are updated?
Right. So two answers to that. One is individually, what can you do? Like I mentioned, I think Twitter is a source I use, but there are a lot of other social media is what I'd say. Like you correctly mentioned, I think there's so many channels where people are putting out stuff. So you end up seeing it on YouTube, LinkedIn, Twitter, you follow the right people, which are just people who are publishing papers, and you get a sense individually. Now you see if it relates to what you're doing. Like, you know, if it's something far off from what I do, I won't read the paper. But if it's something close, I'll read it. The second is through your community. So one is these conferences. Conferences are basically places where papers are presented. So you get ideas there. And then with your friends, right? So depends on what kind of friends you have. But I have certain groups where the new paper comes in, we hear about it. If we would have a lot of institutes, like IIT Delhi has reading groups. So they take, you know, a certain time in the week, and if someone would present a paper and everyone else would talk about the ideas. So individually, you try to look at social channels, everything. As a group, you try to be around people who discuss similar ideas, whether it's research labs, industry conferences, and those people will, you know, teach you more and be your source of ideas.
Awesome. There's a question from Vipula Rate. It is something that I'm not able to maybe understand correctly, so I would just read it out. And then, how do you manage your ideas getting scooped?
Okay, controversial question, which I've not faced that often, thankfully.
Okay.
It's a sad answer. The answer is you just need to be fast. It's as simple as that. It's like, you know, two companies have the same idea and both of them launch it. The one who goes faster usually gets the advantage, while you manage to keep your quality intact. You can't cut corners to get speed, but eventually it comes down to speed. There have been cases, in fact, where an idea we had, and it's not just with me, it's with a lot of people, where you get an idea after doing research for 2 years, you get an idea and think, oh, I've got something groundbreaking. You Google a little bit more and you see that's already been published a year ago. That things like this happen, and all you can do is make peace with it. It's a competitive industry, and you can't really do anything about it.
I think we are 7 billion people, even be 8 right now. So, it's very hard to make sure that everything that comes to your mind, you are the first one to be thinking about it or doing something about it. Amazing. We have a question on how do you transit from a software engineering job to a research assistant, as both are in different domains. I think we have covered a bit on that, both can be done parallelly. Is there anything else that you want to maybe add on to that?
So I'd say the only thing is, I'd say if you don't know, then you try to do them parallelly. If you have even a 10% inclination towards one of them, then make your mind up. Like the longer you, in fact, this is the case with me also, I feel doing both is great, but at some point you need to pick one thing in your life. Like you need to have a concrete goal. So try picking one thing. If research is that thing from a software engineering kind of job, your best bet is that you already have half the skills, right? For research, you need to be able to code. You already have half the skills. Start one of those ML courses and follow pretty much the same steps. Like start reading research papers, put yourself out there, and don't do software engineering to build APIs, for example, or work on databases. Do software engineering maybe to deploy or put in an existing ML model. You start from there.
Awesome. Some institute have good papers, but not traditional. Does quality of paper matters to reputation of or the reputation of the conference? I think just to summarize from whatever I've understood so far, if you don't have a very high quality paper, you would not make it to a conference. So, at all time, make sure that your paper is of the highest quality. It has a lot of information. It is creating a lot of impact. Anything else that you want to add to that, Ramesh?
Yeah, I'd go as far as saying that there are conferences where there's a lower bar, like I think the ones you've mentioned, NeurIPS, AAAI, ICML. I go as far as saying that one AAAI, NeurIPS, ICML paper is better than 50 papers in some unknown conferences. One good thing is something that can add to your value. So the conference definitely matters, like can't emphasize enough on it, definitely matters. And if you can, you should only focus at the top level. The rankings I've shared, I think personally, this might come up as a little snobbish, but personally, anything below B, I don't think people will revert back to you. They'll think that they took an easy way out. They cut out on quality. So, and I myself have some of those lower rated papers. That's why I can say from experience, they've not helped me as much as, and I put in time in them. Like, I put in, let's say I put 10 hours per paper and I got 20 papers. Let's just say I put the same time in one paper. That one paper of higher quality always has brought me.
Amazing. Do you want to talk a bit about these rating systems and how papers get rated, B, A, A plus, A star?
Sure. So like we discussed earlier, the whole idea around a research paper being award winning is how much impact it makes. And impact can quantitatively be measured by something called citations, which basically means how many times has this work been referenced. So kind of like even in a movie, how many times has this movie been watched? How many people paid to watch this movie? Similarly, how many people read this research paper? More importantly, how many people have used this research paper in their next research paper? So like I have two research papers published at the same time. Both are in the same conference, no difference at all. Okay. One of them has been cited 78 times. One of them has been cited 2 times. That automatically means that the one cited 78 times has had greater impact. And the impact at citations year on year is proportional to the rating. So these A-star conferences simply mean that your paper has a much higher chance of discovery by top people. In fact, I'll go as far as saying that once I got some of these A-star papers, I had recruiters from Google Research, Facebook Research, all of these places reach out to me only because I was associated with these papers, which are easily discoverable and easily cited and follow this hierarchy of ratings.
Amazing. Awesome. I mean, that's pretty insightful. The more higher quality research you have, the more it gets used, the more it, the better rating it gets. Amazing. There's one quick question I want to take up from Amir Siddiqui. do you have to pay for your research paper to be published?
Again, controversial question, but at times, yes, you do need to. There are reasons on why, or actually, let me rephrase. You don't have to pay for your paper to be published, per se, unless it's like a shady conference. Those happen. Like I've seen a few of them in India where they'll say, we want 5,000, 10,000 to publish a paper. That's a red flag. But there are, it happens indirectly, where conferences would say, if you want to attend the conference, you have to pay some money. And that makes sense because hosting a conference also costs money, right? You're getting food, you're getting accommodation, all of that. So indirectly, you have to pay registration fees for conferences. But let's say you don't want to attend a conference. At times, you don't have to pay anything.
Got it. Namrata has a follow-up question on our recommendation of colleges that you, how can you go about approaching the IIIT research labs? Definitely, we spoke about emailing them, start cold calling, you know, start putting your work out there. Anything else that you want to maybe add into that?
I'd say one of the mistakes people make is they reach out to professors, which is not a mistake, but you have to understand that they're busy people. What you can do is reach out to people who are interning there, for example. Those are, you know, the most, I would say, younger in their career, early in their career. So they'd have more time to help you out. Like, think of it like this. Reaching out to your friend who does XYZ might be easier. So, for example, if you're interested in IIIT Delhi, reaching out to me is easier than reaching out to my professor. Reaching out to one of my interns is easier than reaching out to me. So you start with people who are younger. They have more time to help out.
Get tracking on LinkedIn, find the right people, connect with them, make some calls.
Networking is key. I think that's also everything around Scalar, right? So this whole concept of building like a virtual university, everything around networking, like ask people and people who are doing what you want, ask them, talk to them, they'll help you out.
And I think just to maybe plug in there, if anybody who's here who's looking to get started with data science, we have just launched an amazing data science program. You can head over to scalar.com. On the top, you'll see Scalar Data Science. Go ahead, click, look into it. You might find something valuable there, right? I'm always happy to chat and discuss if there's any follow-up question on that, right? Great. I'm just going through the last few questions. We don't have new questions coming in. I think we have done either a very good job at answering everything, or we have lost people's interest.
We just got one minute ago. I think there's a huge. I don't know if there's a lag on your side or my side. Like I seem to have quite a few here. Not sure.
Okay. The last question that I have is from like a few minutes ago.
The last one I have is 7:49 only.
Okay.
Anyway, I think let's just keep taking the ones we have.
Yeah. So for an undergraduate, is being able to implement research papers from scratch be considered better or being able to come up with a new novel idea? See, I have to research kind of frame if I want to.
I would say that implementing is easier, but the value it might have would be lesser than being able to come up with a novel idea. So if you can come up with a novel idea and it works, 100 times better than implementing what someone has already done. But it's obviously much more difficult to come up with a new idea than just implement someone else's from there on.
Awesome. Manisha Reddy, is academic research a viable option for earning money when compared to a regular ML engineer job? I'm assuming that, do you go full time into it?
Right. So it depends, first of all, from even country to country. I would say India, because it's on the, I'd say it's on the curve where people are embracing research now. So I think it's becoming a place where there are jobs like research scientist, ML scientist. These jobs, in fact, as far as I know, pay a little bit more than the engineering kind of role. But if you're talking about academic research, maybe along, say, professors, postdocs, things like that, I feel that's a totally different career path. Then I'm not even aware of what the differences are. But very often, even people who are pursuing things like being a professor, they often get affiliated with industry research labs, etc. And eventually, I think that ends up paying more than just the traditional software engineer kind of job.
Maybe I'll just rephrase with this particular piece by saying that, you know, money is everywhere. You have to be really good at what you're doing, right? Even if you become a primarily research-driven research ML engineer, if you are really, really good at it, I'm pretty sure that there are a lot of people who are willing to pay a lot of money to just get your help and get your credentials and get you to look at whatever they are doing, right? So just focus on what you want to do. Focus on how do you become a master of that craft. And
yeah.
काबिलियत के पीछे भागो, पैसे के पीछे मत भागो, बाबा रणछोड़ दास का डायलॉग है. Is it advisable to put your unpublished research paper on argziv.org to get initial feedback suggestion? How to avoid your paper getting plagiarized or scooped before publication?
Okay, good question. I personally don't put them on archive, but some different reasons around that. In general, I would say it's better to put it. It's basically, it's like saying that although the paper is not published yet, we have made it public, so it reduces your probability of it getting scooped. Kind of like saying कि ये movie hall में नहीं release हो रही but ये YouTube पर डाल दिया हमने, something like that.
Right.
So at least no one can copy it completely. But then there are also times when you put it on archive and now you've given other people a basic idea to start from. They can modify it a little bit. I've seen cases where, you know, you put something on archive, people might take your base idea, change it a little bit, and publish their paper with better quality, more resources, whatever.
Interesting.
And once they do that, that reduces the impact of your paper because something better is already published. So it's a trade-off again. You can protect yourself, but it's like same thing. You put a short movie on YouTube, someone makes a blockbuster out of it, then your blockbuster is gone.
Amazing. I think very, very interesting topic. I think we recently came across a news around that, but that's a different conversation of all length altogether. Ravi Kiran Reddy, I think they've touched up on how to work with research labs outside India, start reaching out to them, start reaching out to professors. Is there anything additional that you maybe want to add to that?
No, I'd say if you're in undergrad or if you're basically a student, there are these programs that India has, like I think DadWise is one of them, which has like a collaboration between Indian and German government. So you can apply formally through these things and do that. If you don't want to do these or you're not a student, the best is through conferences. Go to conferences, network with people, meet them, reach out to them, put yourself out there. And it's a tricky thing, you know, it's not very easy, especially because people abroad, their first question is, why should we get someone from India if we can get someone in our own country? So you need to show that you add a certain level of value beyond that.
Just adding on to that same question by Siddharth Kumar, which country do you think is best for academic research?
It depends again. I'd say, US is great. I think it's at the cusp where it's very, very well celebrated. It's very promoted in terms of things like pay as well. I mean, certain research-based roles in US pay much more than the normal software engineering kind of track. But then there are other options. I'd say certain countries in Europe, say Germany, Switzerland, certain institutes, they have a lot of great exposure. Another benefit of Europe over US is that education is much cheaper. So if you're considering something like masters, it's in some cases like Denmark is free. Whereas if you go to the US, in some cases your masters can cost somewhere around a crore. So there's always that difference. India's making progress, but I don't think I'll go as far as saying that, you know, India's amongst the top just yet.
Not yet, but maybe hopefully very soon we'll be there. Okay, one last question from Anish Bose. How to improve research output by knowing whether to publish in a conference or journals?
Okay, I'm a little confused about what the question is exactly, but how to improve
I'm
research.
I'm assuming it's more about how do you get more eyeballs on your paper? Whether do you post it, is it big enough to go to a conference spending that much money, or should you just do a journal? Like, how do you evaluate that?
Okay, I think we can consider it something like difference between a conference and journal, something like that. So I'd say conferences, it depends on domain. So machine learning, AI, conferences are what is hot because you have quick sessions. No one has the time to read 100 pages. People want a 2-minute video that summarizes it. And that's what conferences do. Certain conferences, you have a 1-minute, like a just a minute kind of session. You have 1 minute, summarize your problem, and the next person is going to talk. So those are hot within machine learning, AI, etc. Journal, and the one drawback of conferences, I'd say, is conferences, you submit a paper, 3 months later, you're told either accepted or not. That's it. It's a binary decision. With a journal, you submit a paper, you'll get feedback, and they'll tell you if you can do X, Y, Z, we will review it again. So it's like an ongoing process. But then for journals, you have to take in the marketing and publicity in your own hands. There's no conference, there's no event. So even if it's a great journal, you have to spread the word that, look, this paper came out in this journal, etc. And journals at times can be more time consuming. but they are the preferred mode of publishing in anything outside computer science. So biochemistry, health, they do journals. They conferences are not comparable. But CS, ML, AI, conferences all the way, at least for now.
A completely noob question from somebody who does not belong to data science. If your work has cross-domain implication, let's say you are doing something in data science that also has implication in, let's say, medicals, right? Then does journals start making a lot more sense?
At times it does. In fact, I published recently, we had the option of publishing in a CSML kind of journal and an Oxford Journal of Medicine. That's kind of where you see what kind of impact do you want your paper to have. Would you rather have medical impact or would you rather have CS impact? In our case, we figured medical impact is more real world tangible. So we did that. And so interdisciplinary, you choose, you have a choice, right? You have hundreds of journals to choose from. You choose where it might fit best. In fact, publishing in the medical journal turned out to be well, because if we published it in CS, maybe it would not have got a lot of coverage. It got published in a medical journal, then we had Times of India and everyone reach out, maybe only because it was medical oriented. So you basically pick where you think, you know, what adds the most.
Right. No, makes a lot of sense. Makes a lot of sense. So that's just a bulb that went in my head. Awesome. We have another question coming in from Mohit. Which plagiarism tool do you use to check your paper?
So a funny thing, I've never used a plagiarism tool. I feel like, I mean, I'm very picky about what goes in the paper I write. A lot of, till a year ago, I used to not let my co-authors write. It used to be like, no, I have my own way of writing it. You're not writing it. Now I've got lazy, so we use something called Turnitin. So I some of the interns would use that tool. But in research papers, it's very, very easy to get caught. You should not be taking any risks. One wrong step and your reputation goes down the drain. So just avoid taking any kind of negative steps. In terms of plagiarism tools, if you're in a university, ask your professors. They have free software. Otherwise, any software costs a lot. If you're in a company, the company should have some kind of software.
Awesome. Great. I think we've answered all the questions. So from a journey perspective also, if I just try to walk through the entire journey, we spoke about how to get good ideas, right? You don't have to think of something groundbreaking. You can also think about implementations that are closer to you that you don't see happening right now. You can start putting your content out there. You can start creating videos. You can start creating blogs, Medium. There are a lot of ways of just putting content out there that shows that you're passionate about what you're talking about, right? You can start reaching out to institutes by emailing them, by connecting with them over LinkedIn. Try finding people who are more approachable, interns, junior members of the team. They will be much more approachable. They'll be fast, easier to help you out. Network a lot. Make sure that now in today's time when all conferences are happening online, make sure that you are attending a lot of them. Make sure that you're talking to a lot of people and you're creating those networks that can help you out. Make sure that you're creating a lot of impact so that your paper, people want to read it. People want to derive some learning from there that can be helpful for them. All in all, you know, if you're doing all of these, if you're checking all of these boxes, your paper has a very high probability of being an award-winning paper, right? And if you are still getting started, if you want a lot of help on data science, again, reach out to scalar.com. We have a data science program that can help you out. We will be very happy to chat. We'll be very happy to. Ramit is helping us build that program very closely. He would also, in a way, be guiding you directly, indirectly. So, yeah. Anything else that you would want to maybe add to the concluding statement, Ramit?
No, nothing else. I think I'd say I'm very happy to, you know, use this platform that you have and reach out to more people. I think there's a lot of future in terms of improving the research and machine learning landscape in India. Over time, and in fact, right now, it's booming. So there's a lot of opportunity for even people who are employed already. It's not like you need to change your career trajectory or path or anything like that. It's something that's booming a lot. In fact, people often won't talk about things like compensation, but just based on what I'm seeing, there's more compensation on the MLAI side. So it's great to be on that place where, you know, we can make an impact and tell people how they can upskill themselves. It's a new booming thing. If it's something that interests you, get your hands on it. It might be beneficial for you in the future. So yeah, thank you for attending. Happy Independence Day. And please please do something more fun than this after this.
Thank you so much, Ramit. Everybody have a good evening, and like Ramit said, have a very happy Independence Day. See you guys again next time. Thank you.